So after the discussion of MapReduce and Spark, these frameworks for big data processing, we will now turn our attention to NoSQL databases. NoSQL databases are, like normal databases, tools to store, query, and update information. And here, when you're reading this the first time, NoSQL, it could indicate that there's no SQL support. And in fact, also this is not entirely true, but in fact, in the beginning, these systems came usually with a very limited query languages tailored to the purpose of the application or company that would run such a system. But there are also extensions that are allowing SQL statements, at least in some of these applications. We also emphasize here on systems that are working in a distributed fashion. So again, here we look at scale-out approaches like before, for like in the case for MapReduce and Spark. So as I said already, there is not such one NoSQL system, but NoSQL describes like a whole spectrum of different approaches. There are some which have a very simple query model compared to those that have really SQL support or a subset of SQL. And there are also some systems that have MapReduce support built in. And there are systems which are in-memory systems versus those which are disk-based or a mixture of in-memory and disk. So there's like a huge variety, and there's this website here should be still up and running. This already some years ago listed more than 100 NoSQL databases which were proposed by companies, by researchers, to tailor like the system to the requirement of a certain task. For instance, the shopping basket organization in Amazon would be such a task, which is very prominent in this domain, where you would not need to have full SQL support, but more like emphasize on a very scalable and very quick lookup of the contents of shopping baskets of customers. An example of such a simple system, so-called key value store, is Redis. Hopefully this link is also working still. You can go and try it out. So you can, you have very simple routines you can execute. For instance, you can have here the set command, where you can assign a certain value to a variable name. So here the variable name would be set to DDM17. And when you then issue get, you're getting the value, right? You can also have list operations, but these are not all, but a good sample, a simple sample of those operations you have in a simple key value store. And of course, these operations should be very fast. It's also not so difficult to implement them in a fast way, you would imagine, because there's no joins involved, right? It's more like a, let's say, hash-based mapping of the name here in this case to one server, and then you're retrieving from this server the value. However, as we will see, this is not so easy, because what happens if the server is down and then you cannot access the shopping basket of a customer in Amazon, for instance, your shopping basket? Then you will be annoyed and you go to a different online retail store, and then Amazon is losing money, right? So that means that these systems that are employed in websites like Amazon, they should scale to millions and billions of users, and they should never be down. That means they should always be available, otherwise the company is losing money. In the forthcoming slides, we will look at the mentioned aspect of fault tolerance. In order to achieve fault tolerance, we look at replication, and then consistency levels or consistency considerations. And you all know ACID from database systems course. Here we will look at something which is called BASE, kind of as a contrast to ACID in the context of these distributed scale-out systems. The CAP theorem, which is a surprising and not so surprising observation, that you have to find a trade-off between availability, consistency, and the handling of network partitions. We will see that in a minute, what it means. Also, we will look at how we can place data onto nodes in a network. So if you have, let's say, these four machines and you want to now place the shopping basket contents of the Amazon customers to these. How can you do this? The first idea is you're doing hashing. But what if you do hashing and you know this already from the database systems course, and the system needs more servers because it's overloaded, and you're adding one or two more servers here, and then the mapping based on the, let's say, modulo 4 hash function will be totally distorted, and you have to shuffle a lot of data around, which is of course not good because it would cause system downtime for some time, and this costs money. So you want to have a mapping of data to nodes which is behaving nicer. If you're adding a new node, you don't want to have a whole shuffling around. And this approach that we consider here in this lecture is called consistent hashing, with a very famous concept. Also, if you're looking at different processes, modifying copies of an object, it's also important that you, or that we have a notion of ordering of events in such a system. We will look at a simple notion of timestamp, and also a bit more fancy and powerful technique called vector clocks. We also will look at sample systems and also try them out through exercise sheets. So what are the wanted properties if we have a wish list of things we can wish to be implemented by a system that we are getting to use? First thing is, of course, data should be consistent. Consistency here is not the same, let's say, as the direct meaning of consistency in ACID, in a database system. Here we're talking about, in the lecture here, we're talking about consistency in terms of having replicated data which is in a consistent state. So whenever you write something to the system, someone else is reading this value or this parameter, then they should get a consistent view. This is of course the ideal scenario, but this is our wish list, so we can be dreaming a little bit. This is like what we want, right? The other thing we want is that the system is responding very quickly to the requests we have. We will see an example later on in a few minutes. I mentioned already Amazon, they're losing big money if the system is not replying immediately. So if a shopping or a retail store is slow, you might go for another one, right? And even if you stay in this time, the system is not responding, there cannot be any items sold, right? So the system should be always up and running. Third point, data should be distributed across many machines. It has to be like this because we're talking about big data. So it's a necessity. The data has to be distributed. And of course, if you have this distribution of data, then there can be also problems arising, because if you're replicating data, including replicas of individual data items, objects, there can be some problem keeping all the copies in sync, so consistent. We will see that. The next one is fault tolerance, exactly. So if the system has issues, the system should still be available and consistent. In particular, fault tolerance requires having replicas. So the next in-depth topic we look at is fault tolerance and replica management. This is a classic problem in data management with relations, of course, strong relations to distributed systems. And here are three books mentioned: the book by Nancy Lynch, Distributed Algorithms, and the book by Tannenbaum and Van Steen, Distributed Systems, and then this one here by more authors, Distributed Systems, Concepts and Design. So I guess it's pretty much sufficient to have to listen to what I'm saying, but as always, look at the slides, but as always, if you have interest to go into a bit too deeper into these topics, and also if you have problems understanding in such cases, you should always consult a book. Okay, so here's a sample application I mentioned already, where there's a shopping cart to be implemented for a large online shop. Let's say Amazon. I mentioned already Amazon a couple of times. There's no secret. This is probably the dominant one. So they have to deal with a lot of users, right? And what they have to offer is that if you're going with your phone or with your browser to the website, then you will see your shopping cart, and you can place items in this shopping cart. You can delete items, and this shopping cart should of course always be consistent, and it should be always available, because as you see here in this quote, there was this blog post saying that Amazon, if they have 100 milliseconds latency, then this adds a loss of 1% in sales. And in Google it's similar. If you have a half a second added to the search page generation, so the results page in Google, then the topic decreases by 20%. So for such applications, it is crucial to be always available. Now, if it's like a necessity coming from, of course, from money concerns, right? Now, this is one thing, and the other thing is, of course, these are very big systems, right? And this is exactly the problem we are looking at. How can we realize such a huge system that is always available, pretty much, right? And of course, also correct. So here is a simple illustration of such a distributed data store. You see here in red we have, let's say, some hard disks or some servers, let's say, and they are connected. And there are three processes here that are querying, inserting, or updating specific information. There is a local copy of an item, and there are replicas across the other servers for availability and fault tolerance. And now you can imagine, we will see that next video probably, how we can configure a system now in order to be very good in read performance or in write performance. Now, what can happen? There's this process here, wants to write the value for the copy of, let's say, object A. So now A on this node here will be changed into A prime because it was updated. However, here we still have the old versions. Now if this process that would write A to A prime would not wait until all these copies are written and would go away, then it can happen that this process here, or even the same process, would read from this data store and would read A and not A prime. And this is already what we say, it is not a consistent read, because we have here the old value read, A, and not the new one, A prime. So how can we achieve this? So we can of course achieve this if we forcing the database that is receiving, or our entire data store here, right? We can enforce this not to happen if this project process here is like writing A to A prime, it is written immediately to all of these copies. So it is written immediately, and then this operation is taken as done, considered done. Now, in this case, now we see that we have three copies of A prime, which is good, because now any other process here can read this value and would get the most recent one. However, the downside is that we have to wait a long time until all these copies have been updated. Yeah. So this is maybe not the best thing to do, but it would achieve consistency, full consistency. The other way would be when you're writing, let's say again, this example, we have here our A written to A prime, and here we have the old one still. And now there's this process here wants to read and is reading all of these copies. So now this process will see A and A prime. And if we have some time information, this process can say A prime is the most recent one. This is the one I should read, right? In this case is also fine. And this means in this case, what we did was we were reading from all copies and we were writing to one. The other one was the other way around. We would write to all and read from one. In both cases, we can achieve strong consistency. So the problem is when we have replication, that we have to keep these the values of the replicas in the same state, right? And we can achieve this having some protocols which would enforce this, but they have downsides because they would be too expensive, because we have to wait a long time until all of the replicas are read. The problem is also in this regard, what happens if one replica is not available? Then we cannot write to all. So what do we do? Shall we shut down the system for a few minutes until the other copy is also back? And then we're losing customers, right? There's like many aspects here which are problematic, but there's no way around doing replication because you have to deal with system failures. So we need to have redundant information here. So there are two principled ways to differentiate replication techniques. One is called optimistic replication. The other one is called pessimistic replication. In optimistic replication, you keep replicas not enforced to be in sync. So that means you let them diverge for some time. And then if you're reading and you're detecting a conflict, then this conflict is resolved, if possible, of course. In the pessimistic replication here, you would not allow any inconsistencies at any point in time, and you're doing this by implementing like a synchronization protocol. This achieves then what is called single copy consistency. So the system would always behave when you're reading from it like there's only one single copy. There's also the concept of one copy serializability. So if you have a replicated database system and you have like a concurrent execution of transactions that we always looked at, right, in database systems, so there are multiple transactions running, then we say that this execution in a replicated database is one copy serializable if it is equivalent to a serial execution of these transactions over a single logical copy. And that's the best, the strongest one we can get, the strongest consistency criteria we can get, because this talks about serializability at one point, and the other point is it should behave like working with a single logical copy. This is called one copy serializability. So some illustration here, it's left empty, the slide. I can draw and explain a little bit now what can all go wrong. I have already mentioned this in the other illustration. If you have now here four clients and you have three replicas of the same object, now you can imagine what I have illustrated earlier already, so I will keep it short here, that you have here like a update operation. So then here we have A should be updated. So we have here A prime, right? And here the replica will be updated. Now, since we have here the old values of A, not A prime, the clients reading now A will get the old value of A and not A prime, right? However, if you are enforcing some protocol, then these replicas are not accessible for the other clients until they are updated. And then they are accessible again. And of course, nothing can go wrong, right? This is like enforcing with the strict protocol that these the replicas have the same value. You can also, let's say, allow that these are old, but then you have to enforce that client 4, for instance, is reading all replicas. And then, as I mentioned earlier, then client 4 will see A prime, A and A, and can decide based on timestamps or vector clocks that A prime is the most recent one and can work with A prime. Right? Then, and then there can be all kind of other things happen in between these enforced strong consistency. This is also called eventual consistency, where there is at some point some inconsistency, and eventually it will go away to be consistent. And in this time when you have inconsistencies, then clients can also read inconsistent data and can work with some old value. So then you can have concurrently modified values for this replica of A, which in the end have to be resolved either by, if it's resolvable, by automated means, but if it's really a concurrent modification, then you have to come up with some application logic to solve this. For instance, this is a nice example, coming back to the Amazon problem. So if you have, let's say you modified your shopping basket in Amazon, and the shopping basket now contained a book one and a book two, and you're going to your tablet, and in a tablet you have the empty shopping basket, or let's say not empty, but you have book three, and then you're adding book four, and you deleted this old book three again. And now at some point the system will say, oh, there are two shopping baskets for the same customer. What do we do now? And one solution to resolve this problem is you're just taking the union, right? You're taking B1, B2, and B4. And if B3 would even be here, then you would still stick with B3. So that means you're taking all these different possibilities. And this, of course, like a very wise decision. If you want to sell a lot of books, then this is the way to go. To take the union of the elements you have in the shopping basket replicas for one user, of course. There's one approach called read one, write all. And this is also what I mentioned already earlier, or illustrated earlier. In this case now, the read operation works as follows. There's the client sending a read operation, and this is transformed to one access to a replica in some of the servers. So you're reading only one copy of this object. Hence the name read one. And then in order to achieve consistency, you are writing to all. That means the write is written to all replicas. And why does this achieve strong consistency? Well, if you're writing the change from A to A prime to all replicas, then everywhere there will be A prime. And then the read one will not harm, because you will always read A prime, right? This is called read one, write all, and there's also write one, read all. So there are two of these extreme cases that would achieve strong consistency. And depending of the case, if you have very frequently happening a write operation or a read operation, you can choose among these two in order to find the best one for your data workload, for your query workload to your system. However, these are the two extremes to achieve strong consistency, and we will also look at this spectrum of eventual consistency, which is not enforcing strong consistency at all times. But still, this rover has advantages and, of course, also disadvantages. The advantage is it is very simple, it's easy to implement. It is strong consistent, of course. This is like a big advantage. The read access is efficient, because you're only reading from one node. However, the writes are expensive, because, or the updates are expensive, because you have to write to all of the nodes, and you also have to make sure, you have to wait until the writes are done. And if one of these servers is down, they're keeping one of these copies, you have a problem, right? So that means the runtime for updates is increased, with the advantage of having reads cheap. And of course, you can guarantee that you have a strong, consistent replica management here. The other approach is called primary copy strategy. Very simple, the name tells already. You're choosing one copy of the one replica, and you're calling this primary copy. And all the other copies are simply considered to be derived from the first one, the primary copy. Whenever there's an update coming, you're locking the primary copy, so nobody else can write to it. And then the read operations, they will read only from this primary copy. And the after the update of the primary copy, the replicas are, of course, updated. Right? So the primary copy propagates updates to all copies of it. So depending on, of course, if it's correctly implemented, this should also give you a consistent view of these replicas. So let's imagine there's the network as depicted on the illustration here, and there's some problem in some switches or some connections between data centers, and you have now two networks. They are partitioned, hence the name network partitions, right? So they cannot communicate now. The orange part and the blue part, they are separate. And let's say there was a primary copy assigned to this one here. Now, for this part of the network, this primary copy is still available. However, in order to also have for users in this part somehow the data available, there needs to be also, let's say, we have to make this one the primary copy for the blue network partition. And that means that in the end, we have diverging values. Even the primary copy method guaranteed, if everything works out, that everything is consistent. However, if in this case now, we can don't have much choices. We can say, okay, we focus on the orange part of the network, the blue one will be dead. But then the blue one is not available to our customers, right? So this is like a problem. And in the end, if the problem here, the network partitioning is a problem is solved, we have to somehow bring together these different copies. And now if you're lucky, there was no inconsistency, but very likely it need to be consolidated because of having diverging values for the individual copies. So this is really a problem. And this also makes, in the end, a big part of the CAP theorem, which states that dealing with network partitions and at the same time being available all the time and consistent all the time is not achievable in practice. Like a bit surprising, but also very intuitive result when you're looking at such illustrations and cases that can happen. So we want to have a system which consists of multiple nodes. We need that for fault tolerance and also for availability. It should not have a single point of failure, of course. Otherwise it will be down and we cannot make money if you are a retail shop. We want to have ideally, single copy semantics, so no inconsistencies. Right? And that means also it has to be always available, and we work with multiple nodes. That means if some nodes are failing, the system should still stay operational. What is essential here is that nodes are agreeing on the way they're executing actions, so like a kind of a protocol. And we will see how this can be achieved. This can be achieved through some consensus algorithm. The buzzword here is Paxos, or it can be also achieved by assigning timestamps to the individual commands or read-write operations that are executed in the system. And this is like a main part of the following sections in this course.